Hi, everybody. It's episode 473 of PodQuest.
Hey.
It's Wednesday, September 6th, 2023. I am Chris. With me is Druten.
Hello.
And Walnut.
Hi, I'm here.
How you guys doing?
Oh, you
doing
know.
All right.
I'm doing.
You're doing? What are you doing?
I'm just doing. You said, how we doing? I'm doing.
I'll accept it, I guess. I'll accept it.
Yeah.
Oh, man, it's fucking warm today.
Today and probably the rest of this week is going to be a no-walk day with Chase, and I feel so bad. It's just too hot for him. I don't want to put him through it. I also don't want to put me through it. It's just too damn hot. Mostly don't want to put me through it, but I don't want to put him through it. So, it's freaking, what, 95? Something like that? Yeah, 95 currently right now.
Yeah, I think the last time I looked, it was like 92 with a real feel of 97, and the high was 95, and it's like, that's inappropriate for September.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And tomorrow's supposed to be not much better at like 93, 94. And then Friday about the same, and then it's supposed to rain all weekend. So, hopefully we get to like fall weather. Hopefully next Wednesday, a week from now, we'll start to get fall weather. Halfway into September, which is usually how it works anyway, with how things have been going the past few years.
I mean, it is still technically summer until the
20th. Yeah, fall. It's not fall until next week or whatever. So, 2 weeks.
Yeah, but it's still like September. It should just be cooler. Like a week ago, it was kind of cool.
Yeah,
September 1st. Nice. September 1st is the start of spooky season, and that's when I should be able to wear sweaters. It's that simple.
I guess I'll allow that. Anyway, Rich, what's on the agenda?
It's kind of a light show because like. Didn't really get much done throughout this past week. Some of us might have been busy reading books and stuff. But there was that Mario Wonder Direct on Thursday last week. We can have a little bit to talk about. Cobb started playing Sea of Stars. I have some minor complaints about Fall Guys that I never really realized until it was brought to my attention yesterday. Drew listened to a new album from somebody, I guess. I didn't pay 100% attention to that text thread. And then, Cobb, you caught up on what I'm hearing is probably one of the worst spin-off animes of all time.
Well, this is the manga. So yes. The answer is still yes. It's not great.
Yeah.
They fucked it. They fucked it real hard.
Yeah.
Ugh. So how was the Mario Wonder thing?
It was cool. It actually, so you guys know me. I'm not big into like side-scrolling platformers. I'm not like anything that has a relatively retro feel, which side-scrolling platformers tend to have a retro feel. I'm not very good or big into. But this direct actually got me interested in getting this game. There's a lot of neat aspects and neat features that they have with it. A lot of like slight changes that they're doing to the Mario makeup that, like, actually, like, make it kind of interesting to play along and play with. But you get your choice of every available character to play as. Mario, Luigi, Peach, Daisy, two different color Toads, blue and yellow, and Toadette. As well as four different colors of Yoshi and Nabbit, which I was not expecting to see Nabbit as a playable character. And you're in the Flower Kingdom instead of the Mushroom Kingdom, and Bowser is being Bowser, and so you have to stop Bowser, like basic Mario story.
Isn't it like Bowser has possessed the prince of the Flower Kingdom's world ship or something like that, and he's now
he took over his castle. There's the Wonder Flowers, which you can find throughout the game, which makes the world move. But Bowser took the Wonder Flower and actually became part of his castle and basically became Megazord Bowser and went on a rampage.
That's fun.
Yeah. Like, the graphically and gameplay, like, it looks very similar to normal Mario game, a normal side-scrolling Mario game. It looks like it could be fun to play. There's some cool, interesting features that they added to it. Kind of like a, I don't know how these are going to play out, how you get, how, like, if you unlock them as you go through, but one of the things that you get to do now is before you go into a map, before you go, not into a map, into a level, you can actually pick a special ability to go in with. Could be like a bigger jump, could be one of the things I know on the website I'm on right now to refresh my memory of what happened, is like you can throw a grappling vine, which will hit the wall and grapple you to the wall and help you wall bounce. Some of the other ability, you can only pick one per level. And if you're having difficulty with that level with the ability you have and you die, you can switch to a different ability to help you, try to help you get through that level. So, like, it adds a little bit to the gameplay to where it's not just run and jump and wall jump. But, like, some of the abilities is maybe a bigger jump or a float or, I think one of them was, like a safety fall. So if you hit spikes or you hit lava, it'll bounce you off lava once per level or something like that. Little features here and there that'll help your gameplay or maybe like just bring 2D Mario to the modern age. More modern, I guess, in a sense. Because there are a bunch of 2D side-scrolling games that I do like. It's just the platforms I don't like.
I did see you were playing on Monday. You were playing. Was that the original Super Mario? It looked like the original Super Mario.
Yeah, for stream we did. I was doing my thank you for subbing streams, and I did a retro stream on Monday, and we did the original Mario. We did Wrecking Crew. We did Kid Icarus. And then I jumped on over to SNES and I played, like an hour and a half of Harvest Moon.
Like the original? Oh, that's right. They put that on.
They put it on
Super Nintendo or N64?
SNES. It's the original Harvest Moon on SNES.
Okay. I couldn't remember if that was an N64 game or an SNES game.
I'm sure there is also a Harvest Moon on the N64.
I think it was Harvest Moon 64.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know if it's on I don't even think I looked at the N64 lineup when I was, no, I did because I laughed at the fact that they have both Pokemon Stadium 1 and 2 on there.
That is actually kind of funny that they have both of them, but like,
yeah.
There's no transfer pack or anything. Like, how cool would it be if they would have figured out a way that you could like drop your, Sword and Shield Pokemon into it?
That would be fantastic if they did something like that. Like, I would love that if like, you could use Pokemon Home or whatever to transfer your team into Pokemon Stadium and play Pokemon. But that's a lot of work for a game that no one's probably playing at all. So it makes sense. Not especially since the game that we want them to do that for is that you can already do that in the new Mario in the new Pokemon game. So it really doesn't make sense for them to do it anyway. It was just 3D battling is what people wanted.
I mean, that is true.
Super Mario Bros. Wonder is what it's called. They showed off a couple of the new, power-ups. One of them, you turn into an elephant. That was really the one they showcased a lot more of. I can't really remember the others. The website I have isn't showing them very well. Or isn't showing them off very well. But, like, you turn into an elephant and you can, like, hit things with your nose and your trunk and stuff like that, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, I think I saw that Mario, like, he can just run through blocks and he can actually move pipes as Elephant Mario.
Maybe. There might be certain instances where you can, like, move things and push things because he's bigger and he's stronger. There might have been a freeze flower. I can't remember what the new powers were, and I feel bad. I should have refreshed my memory on this.
It's okay. Drew and I didn't watch it at all, so you're ahead of either of us. I skimmed the everything at the direct article.
Yeah. I told you can play as, what was it, 8, 9, 10 characters, something like that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 plus 5 is 13.
12.
No, 12. but you
I'm
can
the
play,
one that can't do math, guys. Come on.
I'm doing it on the spot. I had to think about it for a second. There's 12 playable characters. 5 of them, the Yoshis and the Nabbit, are invincible. You can die from falling into traps and pits and things like that. But if you get hit with things, you get knocked back or you get stunned for a second. You don't die.
Huh.
So if you're trying to play something a little bit more streamlined, a little bit more chill, I guess you can pick to play as Yoshi or Nabbit. If one of your players is playing as Yoshi, you can actually jump onto to the back of Yoshi because you can play up to 4 players local only is what they said. I don't know if there is like actual co-op play, but they said local. There is co-op. There is online connectivity, but I remember them specifically saying you can play up to 4 players locally. I don't know if that means locally and online, but they were just emphasizing that you can do locally, but you can have up to 4 players locally.
So I think they'll have like regular local co-op and online co-op based on some of the, what's the word I'm looking for? Like language I've heard people use about it. Like I know, I want to say it's the game director said that, he specifically included Daisy in the game so that his daughters wouldn't fight over which one they're playing as when they're playing together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Which makes it sound like that's local co-op. And then I'm pretty sure I saw that there was also online co-op like you were saying.
So there is online capabilities, and we'll get to that in a second. But like the Yoshis, if you're playing as Yoshi, one player can jump on the back of a Yoshi. Even a Yoshi can jump on the back of a Yoshi. So then it raises a question, and they did not answer this in the direct, and I now need to know. If you're playing as 4 Yoshis, can all 4 Yoshis jump on the back of each other?
Probably
not.
Or
can the other, can like one Yoshi jump on the back, which jumps on the back, which jumps on the back, which jumps on the back? Like,
I imagine there's some sort of limitation where it can only be like 2 characters can be on top of each other at any one time. So like the base and the rider.
But it's only Yoshis that you can ride on.
No, I know, but that's what I mean. Like I feel like they probably have some sort of if then statement.
Nintendo, hear me out.
Just buy the game and find out.
A tower of Yoshis. You need a tower of Yoshis.
I think
that's
I saw
all I'm
that.
Saying. Nintendo.
Did I also see that Yoshi and one of the other characters, they don't take any damage?
Thank you for not listening to something I literally
just
said.
That was you that was just
ago.
Saying about that. That's right. I'm sorry. I got distracted.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, so the Yoshis and Nabbit don't take damage. They will still die if you fall into a pit and whatnot, but they don't take damage.
But hey, I at least listened to you say it because I remember you saying it. I just forgot it was you that said it.
It's literally 5 minutes ago. I feel like you have worse ADHD than I do now, man.
I'm very tired today.
and so the other thing is they do have online capabilities, like I said. Basically, I made this joke on my Discord. It's basically like the Dark Souls of Mario games. So you can go into a level and you can see the ghost characters of everybody else playing in that level. You can interact with them. You can talk with them. If you are playing in this mode and you see somebody die, you can actually go raise them and bring them back and it won't cost them one of their lives.
Oh, that's kind of cool.
You can do that, but you don't. I honestly, because I did this even without entering, I'm going to play with that feature probably off. Because it's going to be too distracting for me if I get this game.
So
it's going to be too much.
Did they explain like how exactly that's going to work?
I mean, so I have it up and I'm scrolling through it and I'm in the online area. And it looks kind of like just you decide whether you want to play online or not. And you'll see a bunch of other people's ghosts like running around on the level, on the world map. And then like when you go enter a level, you'll have the ghosts of other people that have entered the level I guess, at the same time as you.
Okay, so it is very much like the Dark Souls. It's
100% Dark Souls. Like, it's, you can interact with them in the aspect of they're seeing what you're doing, so you can wave at them and stuff like that, but, or you can raise them, but they can't interact with your world and you can't interact with theirs. So if they knock out an enemy, if they jump on the head of an enemy in their world that's in the same spot of an enemy in your world, they're not taking out that enemy as well. Like, you have to take out your own enemy. You're not working together. You're just seeing how each other play.
Right. And I did remember, actually, this just reminded me. I remember the Mario game I was thinking did this. It wasn't that you saw the ghost of them, but in Mario Maker, when you died playing a level, it showed you where every other person had died.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So I think I was thinking of that along with games that do the, like, ghost run.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Also, in, like, the overworld, in the world map areas, like, it is more like Super Mario, like a normal Super Mario's, and not a world where, like, where, well, I mean, it's both. It's like Super Mario 3 and Super Mario World, where you can go from level to level and whatnot, but at certain points you get free roam on the overworld. So you'll go into a section of the map that, like, has, like, three levels on it, and you can just run around and do those levels in any order that you want. You don't have to do them in any specific order. But I think, like, depending on the levels you do and don't do might determine which paths you can take out of that section. It wasn't totally clear what they were trying to show with that, but, like, or if you need to even play any of the levels in that section to move forward. Because you could just easily run past the levels entirely to the next section to move forward.
That's true.
But it seems like, if I remember correctly, there are, in order to unlock different levels, there are, like, basically, there are bits that you get. They're like flower bits that you get as you beat each level that you need to spend to play the next level, to unlock the next level or unlock the next castle, to free some of the flower people, the peddlers or something. I can't remember what they called them. So as you play, like, every time you beat a level, you get these currencies that you have to spend to unlock a level, or you doing other things within the game will get you these flower currency bits or something like that. I can't fully remember how it was, but I think it's going to be very straightforward where you're, as long as you play through every level, you should be able, at least, like, play through every level once, you should be able to at least get to every level without having to worry about not having enough flower bits. It's gonna be very easy. Like, it's not gonna, they better not, like, microtransaction this shit. Which I doubt they will, but
I wouldn't be surprised if they did, though. If we're being honest.
No, I would be very surprised if they did in this game. Because this is not a mobile game. This is you're paying a $60 flat fee, $70 flat fee, whatever, for this game. If they turned around and said, oh, well, these things are going to be hard to find, so, you know, you could buy it, or you could Mario Maker the shit out of these levels and find these things to go forward. That's not the game for me. Like, if I have to do ridiculous Mario Maker kind of shit to find these things to move forward to the next level, where the next level is just a straightforward run, I fuck this game. I am not a Mario Kaizo game player. I am not a Mario Maker player. Like,
yet.
No, I'm not. I don't find that shit fun. Give me all of the hard Demon Souls Monster Hunter oriented combat you can. Make me fight the same boss 16 different times until I finally get it. Sure. But if you need me to figure out and master exactly the timing to make this jump, fuck off. This never happened.
All right, Cobb, we're going to watch Richie's streams. We're going to earn the channel points and make him play, like, some ridiculous shell jump heavy Mario Kaizo game.
But, like, while I think that would be fun, like, he would have a bad time with it, and it would end up just being bad for his stream.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, while yes, that would be hilarious, you know, I don't want to ruin his good time either.
There's a reason when I'm in Retro Nights, I stay away from Super Mario World. Like, I have not gone back to that save of Super Mario World. It's the levels that I'm on, the levels I'd have to do because of the game over that I last had. Like, I still know it now, and it still makes me cringe anytime I think to go back into it. I'd much rather play Harvest Moon, which, to be honest, if I'm going to play anything, even on a retro night, and I decide to play Harvest Moon, I'll just go to Stardew Valley, because it's just so much more streamlined. Harvest Moon, SNES, you have to sell each item individually. So, like, if you plant 9 potatoes, and they're all ready to pick up, you have to pick up the potato and throw it into the box, and then pick up the next one and throw it into the box.
Well, that's...
And you have to do that for every crop that you just grew.
That's obnoxious.
So, I'd rather just play any other more streamlined farming sim. But yeah, this one looked really cool. It looked interesting. I like the idea that, they've had it in 2D Mario games, or 2D and 2D 3D Mario games, where you could play as multiple, all the characters. I know Super Mario 3D World had all four mainstay characters to play as. They've had that for a while. I like the idea of, like, oh, these characters can't die, but also at the same time, I feel like that's kind of lame.
Well, it didn't.
It
doesn't look like they get power ups. Power Yoshi. They never showed it, so I don't know.
They didn't expressly. They didn't show that. So I'm not sure.
They showed like every other character with the power ups.
Yeah. Yoshi. I think. Like, they made sure to, like, show off and mention, like, oh, if you're playing with a Yoshi, you can ride on Yoshi's back.
If you're an elephant.
Even if you're an elephant, you can ride on baby Yoshi, on a little ass Yoshi's back. Maybe they expect these to more so be, like, a multiplayer kind of use. The other thing, in multiplayer, like local or however they have it, if you die, they do the same thing in pretty much every 3D Mario game, or if you die not falling into a pit, or maybe if you fall into a pit, it might have something like this. You can go revive them, so they'll like fall to the ground where they died, and you can go pick them up, and if you pick them up in a certain amount of time, it doesn't cost a life. Whereas like in other Mario games, actually no, in most other Mario games, if you died, you came back in a bubble, and they had to hit you. If I remember correctly. In some of the...
Yeah. From what I've seen of, like, new Super Mario Brothers U or whatever.
Yeah. This one was good. It was an interesting direct. It's short. It's only about 15 minutes. It showed you some of the things. I'm just really interested about this whole, like, power system that they have. Where, like, you could sort of customize your gameplay to however you'd like. Like, I like the idea of the grappling vine. If you use this thing to grapple onto the wall to help you along in spaces you can't get to easier. Or, like, somebody like me who's bad at these jumps and things like that, having that extra grapple to grapple onto might make the game more interesting and intriguing. Like, I like this kind of stuff. I'm always for, like, a jump dash and things like that in games like this.
Yeah. Yeah, that's... You know what? Actually, like, you say that, and it's kind of funny that you hate the platformer, like the classic platformer, but you're okay with, like, the, I don't know what you would consider, like, the Mega Mans, really. Like, they're kind of platformers, right?
They're platformers.
They are platformers, but, like...
They're different, though. That's why,
They're different, but they're also...
They're platformers, but what if you always had a fire flower?
Exactly. The thing is, and I think what really frustrates me most about like games like Mario is damage is so minimal. It's two, three hits max, depending on the like original Mario Bros. Whether you had the fire flower or just the mushroom, if you get hit, you're down to small, and then you're dead after that. Like in
because it's realistic
in modern. Come on, if a mushroom fucking walks into me, I'm not shrinking, okay? In real life.
That if you touch, you just die, dog.
And I'm just saying, like, you might not shrink, like, physically, but there are definitely some mushrooms out there that, like, you're gonna shrink mentally.
Also, any fucking mushroom was walking at you, fucking run.
But also, am I shrinking mentally, or am I shrinking? Am I growing mentally when I have those mushrooms?
Well, like, the world around you is going to shrink.
It's going to broaden my outlook, though.
You don't know that. You could have a bad trip.
True. I found the power ups in this article. There's the elephant, which turns the characters into elephants. You can hit things with your trunks, destroy blocks, dash across two tile gaps. There's a bubble power up, which basically it does what it says. The bubble grabs whatever the enemy is, even like a dry bones, and it takes them away. And like, it'll kill a dry bones. It won't just like turn them into bones. But you can also like bounce off the bubbles, so you can shoot them out and jump off of them. And then there's, of course, the Wonder Flower, which gives you an acid trip in Mario. A further acid trip in Mario.
Which, you know, sounds like Mario, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I am cautiously optimistic for this one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like, I liked the original New Super Mario Brothers. I did not like all the iterations they did all that much on that, though.
Yeah.
Like, I felt like they just, it got stale after the first one.
Yeah.
But this one, it looks like they're shaking things up a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like there's at least enough of an update to qualify a new game where it's not just a re-release and a re-release. Like, that's really a lot of what New Super Mario Bros. Did in the DS, 3DS, Wii U era, was just, like, they did New Super Mario Bros. On the DS, and then they did, like, New Super Mario Bros. Luigi, which is just New Super Mario Bros. Plus something, on like, the Wii and Wii U, and then we even got it with New Super Mario World and Bowser's Fury. Like, they re-released something that was on Wii U over here, which is a little bit extra. It wasn't worth a $70 to $60 price tag because it was already a 5-6 year old game, but they still keep selling them at these higher prices, even though it's not worth the increased price.
Which, it, you know, that's the Nintendo way, right?
Yeah. But this one seems like they've done enough, and it's apparently, I didn't realize this, apparently it's been 11 years since a 2D Mario game.
Well, since like a new 2D Mario game, right?
Well, I mean, New Super Mario Bros. U for the Wii U. If you don't count Mario Maker, is what the article says. 11 years since New Super Mario Bros. U.
Oh, wow, was that really that? Yeah, I guess that was early Wii U.
Yeah.
For some reason in my head, I thought that was, like, mid-cycle.
Yeah, because, I mean, the next thing they did was New Super Mario Bros. World. And that was with the cat costume.
Yeah, New Super Mario 3D World.
So, yeah, that's it.
Yeah, that one just escapes you, huh?
I never played it.
It's a good one.
I think what's going to happen with this one as well, Super Mario Bros. Wonder, is there's just too much. At the time that Bowser's Fury came out on the Switch, at the time that it came out on the Wii U, there was just too much at the time that I was playing or that I was going through or that I wanted to get that, like, I never had the time to get it. I never picked it up, and it's going to be, like Super Mario Wonder comes out on October 20th. That is about 10 days before City Skylines 2 comes out, which I'm already spending nearly $100 to get because I'm getting everything.
That's kind of fun. On
what?
That you're going to spend that much on that?
Well, it's the season pass stuff. So it's not like I'm not getting a collector's edition or anything. It's the game and the season pass.
I mean, that is fair. But I just, I think it's funny that it's like, you like those games that much that you're like, yep, take all the money up front and I'll hope for the best.
Yeah, I mean, $89.99, and it gets me the first DLC. It saves 22%, by giving me, the base game, the expansion pass, and the San Francisco set, which is gonna be some stuff, like some new things to put into the game after the game comes out. Bridges and Ports expansion is going to be the first expansion. Yeah, so there's going to be a couple of asset packs coming out that comes with, which is, yeah, I'll be down for it. The only thing I don't care about is the radio stations, but I just will turn those off and have my own unlicensed music going on in the background. But yeah, so there's that, but it's also, like, Starfield just came out, which I'm probably going to get started on. I'm able to actually play Ender Lilies, so I'm going to be playing that. I still haven't gotten God of War, Legend of Zelda, Jedi Survivor, Pikmin.
Yeah, you do have a lot of stuff that you haven't gotten.
Yeah, like, there's at least four games that I'm more interested in over this. One of them being a Nintendo property with Pikmin 4, that there's no way in hell that I'll be getting this. Well, not no way in hell that I'll be getting this. The only way I'll get it is if I decide instead of getting City Skylines, to get the, if it's still available, to get the two Game Pass for Switch and get this and Pikmin if they're both available for it.
Pikmin is really good.
I know. I want Pikmin. I just haven't really had the money to get brand new games in a bit. To be honest, making the choice of getting Remnant 2 over Pikmin was, in my opinion, a bad choice. I enjoy Remnant 2, but I feel like I would have enjoyed Pikmin 4 a lot more. And I'd probably still be more interested in playing Pikmin 4 right now. I'm not saying I don't want to play Remnant 2, but I only want to play it with other people. Because that game is only fun mostly with other people. So it wasn't worth $70.
That's
$60, however.
That's fair. That is fair. I guess you guys want to move on from Mario?
Yeah. Tell us about Sea of Stars. How are you feeling about it?
I like it so far. I've only gotten to play maybe like an hour and a half or so. Do you guys know anything about it?
I know it's like very reminiscent old school RPG. Like it takes a lot of references on like the old school Chrono Trigger and shit like that.
Yep. So it's that like classic 16. Oh, Kaylee. It's that classic 16-bit RPG style. Give me one sec. I'm gonna close the door up here. Eric is not home, so the dog's just gonna keep barking. Alright, back. So, Sea of Stars. 16-bit JRPG style. It's from the people... Do you guys remember the game The Messenger from, like, 2018?
No, I know of it.
So it's the same studio that did that. So, it's Sabotage Studio, is what they're called. So The Messenger was the game where the first half of it was 8-bit, very Ninja Gaiden-esque. Like that action platformer, super hard. You literally play as a ninja. And then at a certain point in the game, you time travel, and the game becomes like a 16-bit Metroidvania.
Okay.
So this is their follow-up. It is not a sequel, but it's supposed to be set in the same world as The Messenger. And so this one, you start out, you're given the choice between two characters, that, at least in the beginning of the game so far, they're both, like, your party members, and the game does tell you, like, right away, like, there's no wrong answer. You're going to get the same game for the most part either way, and you can actually change which of these characters you want to control later on, if that is a thing. So, you know, you're just kind of picking whichever one you think has, I guess, like, the better attack potential. One of them, he's got a curved sword. And his is like sun-based magic or solar-based magic. And the other one is a girl with a staff, and it's moon-based magic.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it's... So far, it's pretty cool. The combat is... It's turn-based, but they give you some stuff to do in it. Kind of like in some of the Final Fantasies, where if you interact quick enough, you'll get like a little extra... Like, Final Fantasy VIII in particular is what I'm thinking of, where with the gunblade, there's that... if you react at the right time while Squall is attacking, you get the bonus damage. This has that too, but it goes both ways. So you get it for defense and for attack. So if you time everything right, you'll get an additional attack that is usually a little bit stronger. Or if you're being attacked and you time a block correctly, you'll reduce damage.
Okay.
It makes it so that you want to pay attention to the battles more than just, all right, here's my attack. I'm just going to wait for it to cycle back around.
Right.
It's just your team followed by their team for the most part. So if you want to attack in a certain order with your characters, you can. Like, you don't have to just default to whatever the game tells you. You can switch who's attacking first and who's attacking second. And the enemies will usually get a little countdown timer over them for how many turns you get before the enemy will attack. So far, it's mostly been one. Like, both my characters attack, then the enemies attack. But I have had one enemy where they had a count of two, I think it was. So I got two full circuits of my attacks before they attacked. And then with magic, you have like your magic abilities. They're also more interactive than not. The female character with the moon stuff, she kind of throws like, it's supposed to be like a crescent moon that she kind of like throws as like a boomerang. But it bounces back and forth, so it'll hit the enemy, it'll come back at her, and as long as you keep tapping the button in time, you keep deflecting it, it does more damage. And if there's more than one enemy, it will actually bounce between multiple enemies, so you can damage everybody. And
You know what other game does stuff like that?
What?
Paper Mario games.
I've heard that before.
It does.
Yeah. And then the guys is less interactive. You just hold the button when you select his magic, and he just charges up a big fireball. But it does do a lot of damage. And then while you have MP in it, it's not like in like Final Fantasy and stuff like that, where you need items to replenish that or you need to rest. You actually replenish your MP by attacking. So every time you use a spell, you just have to attack a couple of times regularly to gain those points back. And then as you're attacking, you're also building up a combo meter that you can then do a combo attack with the other members of your party. And the game is very specific when it's doing like the tutorial early on of like, don't waste this. Like, if you see that it's filled up, just use it, because it's just going to deplete to zero right after the battle. So like, there's no reason not to do it. And same thing with magic. It's like, don't hold on to your magic until the end of the game. Like, use it right away and then start attacking to get your MP back. And then the last thing so far that combat does is there are certain situations where like an enemy will have a series of icons next to them. So far it seems like when they are getting ready to do some sort of magic attack, and it'll either be symbols for magic or symbols for the different type of weapons, either like bludgeoning or slicing. And you basically just have to hit them that number of times to break whatever it is they're doing, whether it's their defense or the spell they're trying to cast. And at least where I'm at now, it hasn't been more than two per attack type. So if you're good and you can hit that extra attack as you're hitting it, you can basically knock that out in one round rather than potentially having them do whatever larger attack they're going to do to you. Which that's kind of cool. And I'm sure as the game moves on, it'll get more and more complicated for that stuff, and it'll be a little more risky.
Yeah,
I guess is the best way to put it. And then so far, like, there has been a story, but it's nothing particularly standout. It does like a, you start the game as the two characters and they're like adults and they're on some sort of mission, but then it very quickly does a flashback to them as children, and you basically find out that they were chosen as like babies to go train at this special temple in the sky. So when they're like adolescent, like somewhere between like 9 and 12, they get taken up to this academy and they're trained for years until they're adults and have full control over their abilities. And then they're sent on whatever this quest is they're doing. But I'm definitely getting vibes that the headmaster of this place is maybe a little sinister. because there are two other of these warriors that were trained before you that are at least 5 to 10 years older than your characters are. And every time they're in a scene, they're kind of like whispering and you're not getting their full conversations, but you're getting like these little snippets that just make it seem that something else is going on and they're not okay with it. But they don't necessarily have a way to do anything about it yet either.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, overall, it's been pretty cool so far. Again, like I'm only about 2 hours in, so I haven't gotten too far into it. Trying to think if there's anything else. It does that thing that a lot of games are doing now, like Final Fantasy 16 did it, where it gives you items to either make the game harder or easier, depending on like what's going on for you. So right when you pass like your final test and you get some of your mission, you get two of these relics. And they're both to make the game easier if you want to turn them on. One of them will refill your health and magic after each battle, and the other one will it'll give you an actual indicator on the screen when you've timed your block or extra attack correctly versus just waiting to see if it happens. That one just seems more useful than it is making the game easier, because it's just going to help you be able to learn the timing a little bit better than not having that and kind of just basing it off of the audio cue if you have the music turned up, or based off of if you actually block or do a double attack.
So, like, have you used the item yet, or is it just you're reading the description and that's it?
I just read the description so far, because I got it before I was getting ready to stop playing last night. I'm going to probably turn them both on and, like, get into, like, a random fight and just see, like, what, like, just see how the game reacts with that stuff on. Like, is it, like, for the healing one, do I just keep 100% health, or is it, like, like it reads where after a battle I just get my health back?
Oh, you definitely heal it between battles. That's what the item says. That's like modern RPGs, or a lot of modern JRPGs do that now, is after combat you regain all your resources.
I have noticed that. Didn't 16 do that?
No, 16 didn't do that.
You did go from battle to battle, like, hurt if you didn't have full health?
Yeah, it's just where you are, there's not a lot of, like, open battling to where you're going to have difficulty.
That's so, like, that was true.
Yeah. As far as I remember, 16 healed you, or didn't heal you between battles. But, like, some of the items, which were accessories that you had to put on and not, like, actual, like, just random items. So, I can't remember if you said that it was, like, an accessory or just an item you turn on.
So, they're called relics. So, you don't put them on, but there's, like, a separate menu that you toggle them off and on.
Okay. So, in 16, they were, like, they actually took one of your equipment sets or equipment spots.
Oh, that's right. I do remember that now.
Yeah. So you could have these things, or you could have, like, more health, like 15% more, which, like, at one point or another, really didn't fucking matter. But one of that, like, they would actually give you the prompts for the timing, and they would slow down time to help you with some of the timing of things. So, like, it would help you, like, it would say, like, it helps you with the perfect dodge by, like, slowing down the game and prompting you to hit the button, similar to, like, an action event or a quick time event or something like that. So I was wondering if, like, that's how that works, or if it's just if it just gives you the prompt. If does it slow it down and give you the prompt, or does it just give you that extra prompt?
So the way that it reads, I don't think it's giving you a prompt on when to do it. It's giving you a notification if you do it. Because, like, as it stands, like, in especially the enemies, like, it getting my attack in is actually pretty easy. Blocking an enemy is hard, because while the game says block right as they strike, enemy strikes aren't always obviously strikes. Like, there's these weird, like, turtle things, that monsters that I keep fighting, that their attacks are, it moves up to you, but then it jumps into the air and, like, pauses for half a second, and then it attacks you. If I try to block as that attack's coming, it fails. But if I block as soon as the thing is in the air, that's where it succeeds. So it's a little misleading because I'm not really attacking at the strike. I'm attacking as they're like getting ready to strike, I guess.
Yeah.
But you don't know if it worked until the game shows you how much damage you took, basically.
Which, I mean, to me, that's how it should be.
I mean, yes, but I could see, like, if people are, like, struggling with a fight, being able to turn on this indicator to so that you can, like, practice getting the timing down a little bit better.
Well, yeah, I mean, if it gives you the prompt and not just... Because the way you're saying it tells you whether it succeeded, well, the game's going to tell you whether you succeeded by the damage you take. So well, if it's giving you the if it's prompting you when to hit the button with each enemy, then okay, that's a little bit different, and that's an interesting item.
Yeah, no, it does not read like it's prompting you when to hit it. It's telling you when you hit it correctly, because you can tap it more than once. Like if I tap it way too early, and I'm quick enough, I can hit it again and potentially get the block off. Essentially,
oh, that's cool. Mm-hmm.
So this will just tell me like if I'm getting it on time that first time. So I don't have to wonder, especially like I said, like there's a noticeable delay for like these turtle attacks between when you're supposed to hit it and when the turtle actually attacks you. Mm-hmm. And those have just been like the only like reoccurring enemy so far. So yeah, I like it so far though. I'm probably going to keep playing it. I have it on Switch, so it's one of those I can just kind of like grab it and play it whenever.
Yeah.
It is, I believe, on Game Pass and on PC Game Pass, so, you know, there's that. And it released on basically everything. I think it even released on
it's available on
PS4 and everything, too.
Yeah.
Well, I just said Switch. That's what I got it on.
Oh, I didn't hear you say Switch. I heard you say Game Pass and PC Game Pass.
Man, now who's not like listening? That's... Jesus.
I'm looking at, like, I don't know. I'm not paying 100%.
You said the stuff about Yoshi like 10 minutes before I forgot about it. I literally just said it was on Switch.
But like... yours was like, I got it on Switch, blah, 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 Game Pass, this, that, blah, blah, blah. Whereas mine was like, you know, there are 5 characters that don't take damage, and we talked about it for a few moments. It's not like it was just a throwout line.
No, I'm going to go with it was a throwout line.
No.
Can't prove otherwise.
No.
But yeah, Rich, when you get back to like your RPG, what have you? You might enjoy this one.
I'm getting back to my fucking RPG. What have you? A fucking Starfield. So, goddamn, stupid RPGs coming out, making me want to play them.
Are you gonna get upset by the fact that you have to pick pronouns at the very beginning?
Fucking pronouns. God damn. Jeez. No, I can't believe that dude... Cobb, you don't know. There's somebody on YouTube. There's a YouTuber, streamer, whatever. That had... I saw at least the short. Or maybe their Twitter post or something. Of them freaking the fuck out because of fucking pronouns. They're like, you have to pick pronouns? What the fuck? That breaks immersion. So I respond to them on Twitter, actually, and I say, oh yeah, pronouns break immersion. Image of, are you a boy or a girl in fucking Pokemon? You know, when you had to pick your pronouns when you went to play fucking Pokemon? Like, come on now. Just Jesus Christ. Well, this pisses me off, this
people
shit.
Suck.
The even bigger, I was this. It was the British guy that freaking out. Was that who you saw, Richie?
I don't know. He's a bigger dude. I might be able to find my tweet, but and tell you his name.
So I saw one British guy freaking out about it. Saw someone's like stitch on TikTok about it. Every other Bethesda game, you're just referred to as a they/them because like, yeah, you pick a sex, but the game doesn't specifically pick pronouns, so your character is always referred to by they, them.
Yeah.
Which is, like, really the thing that pisses those kinds of people off. Like, guess what? You've always been non-binary in every other Bethesda game.
So at least you get a choice now.
Yeah, the internet was a mistake.
Sometimes.
Also, why the fuck is Starfield 140 gigs?
Bethesda.
That's fair. Yeah.
Yeah, heel versus babyface is what their Twitter is. Pop culture commentator. He's a British dude. He's like a balding British dude, and he goes off. So there's somebody named Dan Vask who tweeted out his video. Western gaming industry with the muddy heel versus babyface.
Okay.
And I responded to them with when a game asks you pronouns, it kills immersion. And then I shared the image of, are you a boy or are you a girl? It's fucking hell. I saw somebody. So there was, my Twitter feed is all over the place. There was somebody who posted, like last week, posted, it was them. Yeah, she's like looking very seductive. I looked at her profile after I saw this image. Former sex worker, but like, they're like journalist and streamer and this, that, and whatever. I'm like, okay. It doesn't really matter, but I just wanted to throw that out there. Like, she's posting something very seductive looking, but like, fully clothed and everything. And all she asks as her caption is, would you kiss me? Or something like that. Alright? I took a screenshot because I'm talking about this the next time we record Brise, because this made me so fucking mad, when I saw this. Where is my screenshots library? Screenshots. She asks, would you kiss me? And the person responded, if you're a natural female, then yes.
Yeah, see, that's what I mean. Internet mistake.
Yeah. I fought back and forth whether I should engage, and then I did. I was just like, you're such a gross human. And they responded with, yes. I said, really, bro? I said, bro, really? ? You're such a gross human. And they responded, yes, responding to, really, bro? And then I say, seriously, who says shit like that? And they responded, I don't think it's shit. So I responded, oh, so you don't think. Got it. And that's how the conversation ended. But yeah. Fucking, who cares? Who cares about pronouns anymore? Like, stop. Just stop.
It's just, hey, you to everybody.
I hear more people complaining about the fact that people are choosing pronouns, they, them, he, she, whatever combination, he, they, whatever that you can think of. I hear more people complaining about the pronouns than I do getting mad at the fact that they're getting misgendered. Because even if you misgender someone who has pronouns, who has the non-gender conforming pronouns, they still don't like really make a big deal about it unless it's consistent.
Right.
Right.
So like stop being an asshole when somebody asks you what your pronouns are, or if a game asks you what your pronouns are. Like,
yeah, I've never understood why people get angry about that. It's like, look, just want to make, like, don't want to call you something that's going to offend you.
Yeah.
Like, why is that such a big deal?
Yeah, I just, boy, I'm so mad. So mad. That just, the Starfield thing made me so mad when I saw them say that, when I saw them go off like that.
And see, aside from the internet being a bad idea, Starfield also a bad idea.
I'm hearing that it's actually not a bad release. For there's still some jank, but it's a lot better than normal Bethesda jank. But I'm hearing the game is very good. There is some aspects of the game that are like just very like the random gen worlds are just kind of dull. But, like, overall, like, the entire encompassing thing of Starfield, I'm hearing, is really good. I've been watching some people play it. It looks very good. It looks interesting. I want to dive into it. So I'm trying to figure out if I want to dedicate a long stream this weekend to jump into it, or if I want to dedicate a long stream and another stream next week to just get through Ender Lilies and then jump into it. I haven't really figured that out yet. But yeah. I want to get into it.
I'm probably going to install it on Game Pass just to see what it is. I can't imagine I'm going to play for more than an hour, though, because it's a Bethesda open world game, and those usually don't click with me.
So, from what I'm hearing, it's very important to play through the main storyline first. Like, play through the main storyline, get that done, roll credits on that, and then do everything else.
At least for your first playthrough.
But at least for your first playthrough. Like, other Bethesda games, they've never really, like, pushed, like, hey, do the main story. Especially, like, in Skyrim, and in Skyrim for sure. Like, there was no real main story in any of the Elder Scrolls games. Like, there was a main storyline, but, like, they didn't push you to do that. It was like, oh, you might be a Dragonborn. Go speak to the Dragonborn people. And like, I've never actually done any part of the main storyline in Skyrim. With the probably 40, 50 hours I've put into that game over 5 or 6 playthroughs. But, like, same with, if I remember correctly, with Oblivion, like, it was, like, your dad was king or something like that, if I remember correctly, and, like, you had to escape, but then it was just like, alright, go out in the world. Maybe figure out what happened to your dad. Fallout 4 and 3 are both, like, find out what happened. But, like, you're out in the world. You don't have to. You can, like... Maybe that's what's on your character's mind, but you know what? There's more important shit that's going on in the wasteland. You should probably deal with those as well. So, like, most of these games, it's like the main story isn't, like, the biggest focus, at least at first. Whereas, like, from what I'm hearing, like, it's very important you do the main storyline first, at least on your first playthrough, to, like, get some story beats and then maybe enjoy the rest of the world afterwards or something like that.
Yeah, like I said, I'm probably going to load into it and get bored very quickly just because of the way that those Bethesda games tend to develop and just be like, all right, I see why people like this. I'm going to now uninstall it and get the 150 gigs of my hard drive back.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm like morbidly curious, but like I've yet to ever load a Bethesda game and play for more than an hour. Because I just fucking get so bored of those games.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense.
Yeah.
I get it.
So, because like you said, like, and maybe this one is different if they're kind of pushing you to a story. But, like, that RPG with no actual purpose is just not a good time.
Mm-hmm. So. Welcome to D&D.
Yeah, but at least, like, you're there to... Or, like, the DM is there to... give it a purpose and to make it have a purpose, I guess you could say.
Well, yeah, I mean, but that's the same thing in Bethesda. Like, it all has a purpose. There I heard
multiple podcasts talk about Starfield where all of them complained that there's a quest early on where like it sounds like it's going to lead to something, and all it ends up being is you just get a person coffee and then they never talk to you again.
I mean, sure, that's probably something. But, like, there's a lot of... I could go off about Final Fantasy 16's quest lines at the end of the game.
The side quests in Final Fantasy 16 were garbage.
The side quests in Final Fantasy 16 were hot garbage. Like, I would much rather have had a quest where I just go get somebody fucking coffee than some of the side quests in Final Fantasy 16. And it's not even that they were garbage. There was just too many of them. And then, I'm gonna go off.
No, we're not. We're not talking about Final Fantasy right now.
There was a side quest at the very last chapter of Final Fantasy 16 before you go to the end of the game, where you have to work with Joshua. And then once you finish that side quest with Joshua, it says Joshua will now be with you until you go to the end of the game. He's gonna be as your party member, and then it unlocks the side quest for Jill after you do Joshua's. Where it's like, oh, Jill's been feeling left out. We should go do stuff with her. And so you go do stuff with Jill. And then it unlocks and says, Jill's now going to be a side quest or a character with you until you go to the final location of the game. I did those quests last. Because I didn't know. But Joshua still stuck with me the entire time. Because once you get his quest, he goes with you until you do his quest. But I unlocked my extra character, my bonus character, as the very last quest of the game.
Well, that sounds like just a bad order of operations on your part. No fault of the game.
The game should have told me that there was a possible quest. Like, there should have been known that there was a quest to unlock another character. Or, you know, maybe that character's quest should have been unlocked right away. Because, like, I didn't do it less because I wanted to help Joshua last. I did it because, there was more quests in this location and then that location, and this location only had the one. So I did the quests, the multiple quests first, and then the one location last. And that's why I did it that way. Because, like, it made sense to visit this location where there's three quests available, do that first, and then this location where there's two quests available, then that location where there's another three, and then this last one where there's only the one, to get them all done right in a row, bam, 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 bam. But anyway, there's too many side quests in Final Fantasy. Anyway,
there is.
Anything else about Sea of Stars?
I don't know. No. Starfield. Why don't you tell us why you hate Fall Guys?
So, Drew.
Yes.
You play a lot of Apex, right?
I did for a while. For sure.
You've purchased the Battle Pass in Apex, correct?
I have.
And in getting the Battle Pass, whether you purchase it or not, if you complete things along the Battle Pass's dog, really? He's scratching himself.
Is that what that weird noise is?
Well, he's chewing his front paw or front leg to scratch himself, which is causing him to actually do the bicycle kick on his back leg because it feels that good.
Oh, geez.
So that's what it is. And he's laying right under me. He's dumb. So when you do the battle pass, whether you buy it or not, when you do the battle pass, every level you get something, right, Drew?
Right.
But if you buy it, you basically get two things per level, correct?
I don't...
Usually. Generally. But, like, you get more if you buy it, but generally, if you don't buy it, you still get stuff. It's basically what I'm trying to get at. Like, every level, whether you buy it or not, you get stuff. For the most part. Like, whether it just be currency or stupid game currency or some cosmetics or things like that, you don't matter. Generally, every level, you get stuff.
I feel like that's not the case for most battle passes, honestly. Apex, I'm pretty sure you only are guaranteed to get things every level if you've paid for it.
So I just did the Sea of Thieves battle pass, and I got things every level, and I did not buy the battle pass until I reached level 100, because it's not worth it unless you reach the level 100. And you get things for most of the levels, if not all of the levels, for having the battle pass. For not buying it. And then you get things, extra things for buying it at those same levels. In Fall Guys, most of the stuff you get with the Battle Pass, you have to pay for it to get. And yeah, it locks it behind the Battle Pass. Which, like, in my experience of Battle Passes, you get stuff every, if not most, levels, and those levels that you get stuff usually you get doubled up if you pay for it.
I feel like that's the exception, not the rule.
And in my experience as well, usually when you do the battle pass, if you reach level 100 and pay for the battle pass, that pays for the next battle pass, generally.
That, yes.
Fall Guys, you get only 500 of the 600 that you need for the battle pass. And you can't buy in sums under 1500, or no, under 1000. So, you have to spend $7 for that 100 gold to get the... I'm just like, I'm so frustrated at this, because I'm like, I'm going through it, and I'm like, I've been playing this game quite a bit here and there for the past couple of years since it's been out, on PC, on PlayStation. I don't understand why I don't have more stuff unlocked. And it turns out, because I was getting the Battle Pass levels, or the Game Pass levels, but I wasn't buying the Game Pass, so I wasn't getting the unlockables. And I'm just like, that's bull. Like, I get not getting everything. I get having things locked behind the Battle Pass. But at least, you know, maybe give me more currency for other cosmetics. Because in Fall Guys, it's wild that, like, they have a select few things that you can buy through the normal purple coin currency that you get by playing the levels, but it's like three things a day at max. And then after that, it's all premium currency. And it's like not cheap premium currency stuff. And then to level up like your profile to get like some of like the main game level up stuff, like the cloud costume that you could get if you get to 100 of your character. Like, you need, from what I was seeing, you need like 1,400 crowns, which means you need to win up to 1,400 games or get 30 or 60 times 1,400 little crown pieces in order to get that. And I'm just like, I found this out yesterday, noticing it when I was playing Fall Guys on stream. And I'm just like, this is nuts. I didn't realize how bad, like, is Fortnite this bad? Is, like, I know Fortnite has a lot of microtransactions for cosmetics, but it seems to look like a lot of people are just running around as Spider-Man and Aaron Yeager for, just because. It doesn't seem like they really had to buy this shit. I know people who aren't spending money on these games running around as these characters. So, like, is Fortnite this bad? Is Epic just this bad with microtransactions? Or is it just Fall Guys?
I feel like it's just Fall Guys.
Yeah. That was my little, like, gripe with Fall Guys. Because, like I said, I've played it. I've reached, like, levels 20s into Battle Pass, into, like, Season Passes and whatnot. And, like, every time I play the game, I'm like, why don't I have a lot of unlocked stuff? Why don't I have a lot of things? And it's like, I got... Right now, they're doing a Final Fantasy XIV crossover season pass. Which I'm like, alright, this is cool. And if you buy the season pass, which is like 600 premium currency, you get a yellow gold chocobo. But if you reach 100, you get black gold chocobo. Which I'm like, you know, I kinda want to get that black gold chocobo. Even though I only play Fall Guys like once every like month or so, I kinda want this costume now. But like, I'm not gonna buy this season pass until I get to the top because... Or basically, I'm not going to buy the season pass until I get to level 82 or 88, because I would then have to spend this $8 to get the 1,000 currency, and at that point I would have the 1,500 needed for the premium season pass, which would give me the 12 levels from 88 to 100, because I'm not going to spend this money on anything otherwise, rather than, I was like, man, this is ridiculous. Yeah. I thought it was nuts. If you're saying it's otherwise in most games, I feel like most games I've played that had the season pass, you might not get things every level, but whenever you get things for both having bought it and not having bought it, based in my experience.
Yeah, and that's the thing. I feel like, and like, I've never done a season pass or battle pass, whatever they're called. But I feel like whenever I've seen and looked at them, it's more of a, you'll get some rewards for like completing it, but also by completing it, you might just earn the, the currency to buy it.
But like, it's not always you'll earn the currency to buy it, but like, based on my experience, like for instance with Apex, if you reach level 100 in the season pass and pay for that first season pass, you get enough of the premium currency to pay for every season. Pay for the next season pass. And So that's like kind of how they get you is, well, now you need to do the next season pass and get to that level 100 so you can pay for that and then have enough points for that. But it's like, if you play it smart, you don't pay for the season pass until you get to level 100. This way you don't waste that money that you just got. Like I guess, yeah, mm-hmm. It was weird. It was like, to me, I was like, this is such a weird system.
So I was real quick looking. You definitely don't get something every single level in the Apex Battle Pass unless you've paid for it.
Mm-hmm.
So, and like, I know the Diablo Battle Pass, there was very little stuff unless you paid for it. Yeah. Though, the things that actually affected the game, the Ashes, which like could give you more experience or more gold when you sell stuff, those were 100% in the free tier. Like, everything else is just cosmetic stuff, so it's like, whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would pull up the Sea of Thieves Battle Pass right now, but that would mean I'd have to open the game. I don't know how it would affect anything, so I'm just not going to do it. But, like, maybe it's more just the way they were showing it off, because the way they show it off is just, like, level 1 you get this, level 2 you get that, level 3 you get that, but it's just a little free icon or lock icon. And if it's a locked icon, it means you have to pay for the battle pass. And it's not, like, separated between the two, where a lot of games do the season pass of here's the free stuff and here's the premium stuff.
Yeah.
It was just, it was weird. And I was like, I don't like this. I don't like it at all. But also, like I said, you only get 500 of the 600 premium currency if you play for the season pass. So you still have to pay for the season pass money either way. So it's like, at that point, it's not really, it's only for the cosmetics. It's not even worth, like, doing it. Like, when you reach 100, it's not really even worth doing it, because then you don't have that currency for next time. Well, you do, because you had to spend $9 for 1,000 currency.
Man, fucking game currency, right?
Yeah.
Dude, I was so confused playing Fall Guys last night. Because like I said, I was like, I don't understand why there's not more stuff for me to buy in-game. Like, I don't even know what the currency is called. Just the purple coins, which is the basic currency you get for just playing the game. Like, I don't have a lot of it. Like, 10,000 of it or something like that. But why is there only 3 things for me to buy? And then everything else is premium currency. And then, like, I'm going through the season pass, and I'm like, what does this currency mean? And it wasn't until later on that I was, oh, so you need the crown pieces to level up your character level to get things. And then you need the premium currency to buy the premium content. And then you need the regular currency just to buy the three things every day that they're just gonna let you buy with the purple coins. And I'm like, so either I play this game every day, and buy whatever I can buy whenever I can, or I just never unlock new stuff. And I'm like, kind of lame. I want to look different, but I don't want to spend money on it, because, I mean, I have put decent hours into this game. It's just the way their battle passes work and the way their reward system works. You need to put thousands of hours into this game to make it worthwhile.
Sounds like you need to become a full-time Fall Guys streamer.
No, yeah. I can really only handle like maybe an hour or two of Fall Guys before I start to get bored. Especially, they have very bad RNG when it comes to level select. I don't know how often you guys might have played Fall Guys or how often you play Drew lately, but they have like 12 different seasons of content and levels that they can pull from. But whenever you play, or at least for me, whenever I play, I tend to get like the same rotation of about 10 levels each day.
Yeah, I felt that way the last I played it a while ago. I was like, yes. Oh, I just keep playing the same things, okay?
Yeah. So it's like after about an hour or two, I'm like, all right, I'm bored.
Mm-hmm.
I'm bored because I'm just playing the same levels, and like I tend to get to the last level almost, I would say 80% of the time I get to the final show.
Listen to Pro Gamer over here.
Look, if you know how to play the game, it's not that hard.
I mean, that's true. Like, unless somebody, like, intentionally fucks you up, like, yeah. I don't remember that game being all that difficult.
I play worse when I'm in a duos than I do solo, because it's like you have to rely on the other people, and sometimes they carry you, sometimes they don't. But, like, most of the time, I can at least make it to the third show, or the third episode, or third whatever. Third game, but most of the time I will get to the fifth game or the last game, the final game of each show.
Are they called episodes or something?
Each time you play, it's a show. Like, you load the show, but so I don't know if like they break it down as episodes or just games. I don't really know.
Okay, I have not. Excuse me, I haven't really played it since it launched.
I don't really know the terminology. And all this, because you'd probably still be playing it on your PlayStation. You'd have to download, it's weird. I tried doing the PlayStation version. So there was a while where I couldn't play it on my PC, no matter how many times I uninstalled and reinstalled the game. It just would not load the game, and I don't know what it was. So at one point, I go to load it up on the PS4, or on the PS5, and I loaded the version that I had that was free for PS Plus users, which is no longer a viable version. So I go to load it up and enter it, and they're like, you have to download this different version now, which is now their free to play new version, that their current version, which is their next gen version. and then hope that everything transferred over that I had prior to the new version.
Oh, that
which
sucks.
Then also sucks because everything I have on my PS5, I don't have available on my PC, my Game Pass or my Epic Store version, which I'm like, I want some of this classic stuff. I want to be able to use some of this old school outfits, like these retro outfits that like no one else has, because like I started the game at day one, but I can't use it because this account was started, quotes, I made obvious quotes even though you guys can't see me, this account isn't an original account even though it was, and I can't, it's not cross save compatible.
Which is a bummer.
Yeah.
I forgot that game even actually went free to play.
Yeah, mm-hmm. they went full free to play, what, like 2 years ago, I think?
It's been a while.
Yeah, I mean, that shows how much I paid attention to Fall Guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, fair.
Yeah. But, Drew, would you like to tell us about Spanish Love Songs?
Yeah. So, Spanish Love Songs, they're an emo, indie rock, whatever kind of band, definitely in that subgenre of music. They put out a new album, their first new album in 3 years, I guess like 2 weeks ago. I think it was the 25th of August, but I finally had time to be able to sit down and listen to the whole thing, and it's really fucking good. They'd put out a few songs throughout the year before, so leading up to it, so I had heard like Haunted and Cleanup Crew, which are I forget if they put out three or four songs before, but definitely Haunted, Pendulum and Cleanup Crew had been out before the full album came out, and those songs are all fucking super amazing. I think Lifers was out before the full album came out as well, but I don't remember 100%, but yeah, it's just a real good indie rock emo album. They're a band I got into like a couple of years ago, and tried to see earlier this year, and they played Kung Fu Necktie, and the show sold out in less than a minute.
Oh wow, was it just them, or was it somebody else that sold it out?
No, I'm pretty sure it was just them.
Oh wow, good for them.
Yeah, and then they're playing in November with Hot Mulligan at a show that sold out in like a week, but I did get tickets for that, so I will get to see them later this year.
Where are they playing at?
The TLA, I believe.
Oh, okay.
Or no, it's either the TLA or the Fillmore. I think it's the Fillmore. But
so at least, like, in Philadelphia, you don't have to drive up to, like, Asbury Park or something.
Yeah, no, in Philly. But, yeah. It's just a real good, like, they definitely lean on, like, our songs are talking about some depressing shit for the most part, but, just really well-produced album and all.
Yeah, they're a band that I've always, like, thought, like, I should listen to them, and I just never remember to.
Yeah, they're real fucking good. The song that got me into them, I always forget the exact name of it, because it's long.
Wow, what a fake fan.
It's long and has a parenthetical.
I'm just saying, fake fan.
Man, it's easier to remember, like, short song names. It's real hard to remember things that are, like, seven-word names that have parentheses in them.
Is it, though?
Sounds like a good song name right there. So you it is a good short song names. But it's hard to remember long song names.
I got punched in the nose for sticking my face in other people's business.
Oh, it's self-destruction, parentheses, as a sensible career choice.
I mean, that seems like a very easy thing to remember.
Well, that album also has two other? Definitely one other parenthetical song title. Oh, it's the album before that has the third parenthetical song title. So their 2020 album has Self-Destruction, and then Optimism as a Radical Life Choice. So those songs, well, both great.
At least they lean into, you know, silly song titles for emo bands.
Yeah, I mean, they're not as, like, ridiculous as, you know, like, old Fallout Boy or, like, Hot Mulligan. Hot Mulligan's definitely taken up the Midwest emo weird long song titles.
Yeah, like there's a whole genre of those bands from like 2003 to 2009. Let's say.
Mm-hmm.
That it, you put all their song titles together and it probably like spells out a message.
Oh, I'm sure.
That's fun. New but music's fun.
Yeah, new music. If we had kept going with the albums for book club, the No Joy by Spanish Love Songs was going to be one of the ones I recommended.
I think we tapped Richie out on albums that he knows.
No, I'd probably have pulled a few more out my butt.
I don't know.
Or just anytime it came to me, I would have just been like, here's this foreign film that we should watch.
You and your bad movies.
I don't know, man. Some people are high praising some of these foreign films that I haven't watched that I should probably watch, like RRR, but that's on Netflix, so it's being struck, but I think technically we can watch it, because
it's also just so long. Isn't it like a 3.5 hour movie?
Yeah.
Something like that, sure.
That's such a long movie with subtitles.
We're reading a 450-page book.
Yeah, I know, but you can read a chapter, put it down.
You can watch a chapter and put it down.
That's not really how movies work, though.
I mean, you could, though.
I mean, I guess you could.
You could get to a stopping point in a movie and be like, all right, I gotta walk away. I watch an hour, walk away. Look, I'm a fifth of the way through the book at this point, and I only started, I've only read it twice so far. I might be done the book before next week.
Good for you.
I almost waited to start reading until after today. But then I was like, I don't know if I'm going to have time enough to read enough to get to the midpoint before next session. But like, I read about 50 pages on the first day I sat down.
So just need 150 more. That's not bad.
Well, I'm at 90 pages at this point. Oh,
okay. I'm sorry. I misunderstood. I thought you were 50 pages in. I see what you're saying.
Yeah. I'm almost about page 100, give or take. I stopped because I got to a good stopping chapter, and I had already read for like an hour or so the night before.
Yeah, that makes sense. So yeah, you'll definitely be at 200 by next week.
Like I said, it might be done. depends on if and when I can read. I might be done before next week.
Let's not get ahead of ourselves.
I'm just saying.
You're going to get distracted by something. We all know it.
I try not to. Trust me. I have music playing with earbuds. The book is like right in front of me because at least the book I have, the words are so fucking small. And the book is so thick.
I will say,
hand to hold.
I saw you post the picture of yours. I like your cover better than the cover of the one I have.
I think I like yours better, Cobb.
I forget why I liked yours better, but I liked yours better.
I don't know what his cover looks like.
Do you just like blue more than red, Cobb? Is that...
You know what? Probably.
Could be. I mean, the Lost World is the more red. It's the red one for me.
No, but like the cover I have is just like the current mass market paperback from like 5 or 6 years ago. I don't know if they've changed it since then. Of course, you search Jurassic Park and it's all the movie. You sons of bitches.
I just sent the picture in the group chat.
Oh,
like
you're, no.
It's very clean in my opinion.
Oh,
I've
yeah.
seen that
yeah,
version. I've seen that cover before. Honestly, I would much rather have that book because it looks like it's taller.
Eh.
And so maybe...
I don't know.
Maybe,
it's a pretty average mass market paperback.
It's barely bigger than my phone. Like, maybe a quarter inch taller than my phone.
I got it. Let me grab the other one because they're the same size. Because I bought them in a two pack. Oh, boy. Yeah. So the books are just about as tall as my phone.
Yeah. So yours is also just the standard like paperback size. You'd probably like not that you want to spend the money on them because they're too expensive, but you would probably prefer like the hardcover because they're bigger generally.
Yeah. It's more so. I need it to be. I need the words to be a little bit bigger because it's just it for me to focus. I have to have it really close to me because the words are so small, and then of course the book is so thick that it actually hurts my hand to hold open.
Always finding excuses.
I'm not finding excuses. I'm working through it. I'm working through it. But let me tell you, my hand hurts sometimes after reading it.
I mean, like I can understand that, especially depending on how you're sitting with it.
Yeah.
Like, if you're literally sitting in a chair holding it up to your face, like, I could see that being uncomfortable.
I think once I get, like, more halfway through and, like, the pages are more, or the spine is more used to being open that way, it might be looser, it might be easier to hold. But it's just, like, because the words go, like, almost right to the middle, it's, like, you have to hold it, like, fully open in order to read. So I don't know if like
that is usually how a book works.
Well, sometimes the margins are a little bit bigger in some of the books I've read. The margins on this one are really small.
It depends if you have like that very standard paperback size or not. Like if you go into a bookstore and like look at like the general fiction section, all of the paperback books are generally about the same size. It's the new releases that aren't hardcover releases where you tend to get ones that are maybe a little taller, a little wider, font might be a little bit bigger, page count's going to be a little different.
Mm-hmm. And also, the last book I read, which was in 2020, was a hardcover book. So.
I didn't know you read a book 3 years ago.
Yeah, it's just as the pandemic started after I got laid off. I was like, you know what, I need to get out of this crazy world and get out of my head. And the book I decided to read was kind of worse. it's a Batman book.
I've talked about this a little bit. Right. I do remember this now. I didn't realize that was just 3 years ago.
Oh, yeah. It was 2020. I think
it feels longer ago.
I think it's like The Darkest Enemy or something like that. I can't actually remember. I see it over there, but I can't actually read the title of it. But it was about like a child slavery prostitution ring. And yeah. Oof.
Yeah, man. Books are great.
Yeah. Yeah. It was interesting. He goes to war. He goes to war against these people. Like, he actually kills people.
Hey, look, I'm reading this book right now. It's called Blood Over Brighthaven. Where you have a character. The main character is a girl who just managed to get hired to be a high mage, which is generally something that only men do. She is the first female to ever do it. All she really, like, anytime it's brought up, she kind of, like, expounds on how male-dominated it is and how everyone, like, thinks she's a joke and stuff like that. But then every other word out of her mouth is also racist and classist against her lab assistant, who is, like, another race that, like, her entire culture looks down on.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, holy shit, this is just incredibly dark all the time. Like, yeah. Everybody is just being oppressed in this book. I wish I could remember it. One of the chapters has like an epigraph all the chapters have epigraphs before it, but one of them, it's like supposed to be like a verse out of like their religion's Bible. And it calls them like calls this other race of people wretches, who they need to fix. I'm like, wow. All right, then this is not a happy book. I assumed Blood Over something would have been, you know, lighthearted, fun, comedic romp, but not so much.
Hmm. Yeah.
Anyway, Drew, anything else you want to mention about Spanish love songs?
No.
Fair enough. So the last thing we have then is I caught up on Boruto, the manga. I don't have it in me to watch the anime.
Did you cry when Kurama died? I don't know how caught up, how far.
Oh, that was like 2 years ago.
Yeah, okay.
that was, so I guess, spoilers for Boruto. That was very sad.
Did you cry when Kurama came back to life?
He hasn't.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Like, he is as dead as he can be as, like, a not really alive thing.
He comes back in, like, 10,000 years or something like that.
Well, so we don't know that with the way that they did this. So, historically, like, had Naruto just been killed, Kurama would have eventually just resurrected, like, his chakra would have basically just eventually reformed into the Nine Tails. What he did, though, was literally give Naruto all of his everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So he burned as hard as he could, as fast as he could, and gave Naruto, like, that huge power-up, and then faded away into nothing. So it's possible that he is actually just gone.
Yeah.
But, like, Naruto still technically has, like, at least a little bit of every other tailed beast.
Mm-hmm.
And he still has Sage Mode. So, like, he's not, like, completely crippled or anything. But that was a very sad chapter. But I stopped reading it, like, last September. I kind of fell off. And the new... So they just did their time skip and, like, relaunched it. Like, it went on hiatus back in April or May, and then the last week of August, they relaunched, like, it's got a new title now, and it's a new number one, and it's, I want to say they said 3 years later.
Boruto Shippuden.
No, it's, like, a worse name. It's, Boruto the Blue Twin Vortexes or something stupid like that. Like, it's real dumb. Basically, what they did was they set up Boruto has been possessed since the movie by one of the Otosuki alien people. Because basically their whole thing is they can implant themselves in a host that is genetically compatible. And then over time actually just take over and become themselves in that person's body and actually transform their body to match what they are supposed to look like. So that's kind of been, like, the ongoing thing with he, rather than having a Nine Tails, he has an alien superpower monster thing in him.
Yeah.
And then you have this other kid who they find that was also one of these things for a different Otosuki, who he manages to get rid of his, but Boruto doesn't. So he swears that if Boruto is ever losing control, he'll kill him. Like, it's one of those, like, they make a pact about it. But the other kid kind of loses his fucking mind at the end of this shit and decides that he just has to kill Boruto because he thinks that the alien monster is there. So he uses his crazy alien powers to trap Naruto in, like a pocket dimension. So you take him out of the book immediately. And then he uses this other person's power to do a mind swap, basically, on everybody. And make it so that everyone thinks that he is actually Naruto's son. And Boruto is the weird kid they found that they welcomed into the village. And who has now just killed the Hokage and taken off.
Mm-hmm.
And the only two people that remember that he is him is Sarada, and who is Sasuke's daughter, and one other random girl. Everybody else was susceptible to this lady's super magic power thing. So everyone is out to kill Boruto. Sasuke actually trusted his daughter and saves him, but doesn't believe that he's actually not a bad guy. So,
yeah.
But, like, that's kind of where it ends. It ends where Naruto ended, and Naruto didn't end, but, like, Naruto did their time skip where it's like he left to go train. And it wasn't really, like, a dire situation. Like, he was training to be able to go get Sasuke, but, like, everything at the village was, like, mostly fine still.
Yeah.
In this case, it's like he's going to train to go try and, like, basically, like, kill the guy who he thinks maybe killed his family.
Mm-hmm.
While everyone that he knows and loves thinks that he's actually a killer and are out to get him. And it's just, it's not good at all.
Yeah, that's what I hear.
Like, that they once they introduce superpowered aliens, like, it just... Like, they jumped the shark too hard with that.
You know what it sounds like? It sounds like X-Men.
What do you mean?
Like, it's just too much, and it just went crazy, and just, like, it was really good, and then it went bad, because they just did too much.
But, like, X-Men can still, like, have good stuff. I feel like where they're at with this, like, there's no saving it, because they just... It's kind of like the Dragon Ball issue, where Goku and Vegeta keep getting more powerful, so then they keep having to introduce ways that somebody can be stronger than they are, to the point where they're now fighting people with literal god powers, or people that have wished on the Dragon Balls to be the strongest.
Yeah.
But in this case, it's like, that's not an option here, and they're not going to other universes or other planets where potentially there are stronger people. They just keep bringing stronger threats onto their Earth, and it's like, cool, so you can't really have ninja battles anymore because most of these, like, main characters have absolutely broken superpowers.
Yeah.
Like, there was, I remember, I think it was just an anime-only episode, but there was an anime-only episode where some guys tried to do, like, a heist at the village, and, like, Boruto and, like, two of the other kids tried to stop them. They failed miserably. The train's getting away, and then Naruto just basically teleports in front of the train and just stops it with his bare hand. I'm like, yeah, I guess, like, that is kind of where we're at now. Like, the dude fought like a god to a standstill, so I guess the train's not really going to stop him.
Yeah, I mean, he is a half god. Like, him and Sasuke are half god.
Well, like, and so that's why they took away their powers, I think, for that exact reason. So that they then had to turn and be like, well, now Boruto and the other kid are now actually the most powerful. They just don't know how to use their powers, because Naruto lost Kurama and Sasuke lost his eye.
Oh, he somebody took his eye out?
Boruto.
Jesus.
Yeah, so in the same issue that Kurama dies, the alien thing that is, like, partially possessing Boruto pops out of nowhere and stabs Sasuke in the, I forget the... What's the fucking special eye that he had? The Rinnegan.
Stabs him in that eye. Rinnegan,
So he still has his other eye with the Sharingan in it, but not the one that lets him, like, teleport and open up pocket dimensions and shit.
Yeah.
So, like, the only way to get Naruto back is to get the other kid to, like, stop being a fucking monster and let them out of the pocket dimension.
Yeah.
But Shikamaru is now the Hokage.
Which makes sense. Makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's like him or Sakura. They're, like, the only two other people that could reasonably do it. Because, like, Sasuke's out actually protecting the kid who's an enemy of the village now.
Yeah. Sakura, like, yeah, I guess. Maybe. But...
So...
Shikamaru, like, he deserved it more than Naruto did.
I mean, intelligence-wise, yes, but... I will give them credit, like, they at least with the time skip, when they do show Naruto doing stuff, he is actually a, like, legitimate, like, ninja, and in their sense of the word now.
Yeah.
Like, he's not just Shadow Clones and Rasengans anymore. Like, multiple times he does other moves. Like, he does the hand signs and, like, does cool shit.
Yeah.
Versus, like, the entirety of his series where it was just like, I know two moves. I'm going to beat you with two moves, or I'm going to talk to you until you give up. Those are the options. But yeah, it's just, it's a shame. Like, I did really enjoy Naruto, and this book is just not good.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought I would give it a shot because they did the time skip and started it back up, but the way the time skip opens up is still just like, yeah, this is still not good, and all of the characters look like shit.
Yeah.
Like, all of their, like more grown-up looks are just fucking awful. And it's not Kishimoto doing the art anymore. He's doing the story again. They fired the guy that was doing the story. But somebody else is doing all the artwork, and it just doesn't look good. Like, proportionally, everything's just odd. Like, people's heads look too big for their bodies and stuff like that.
Maybe he can recover and make the story worthwhile, but It doesn't seem like he's going to be able to.
Yeah, like, I don't expect them to. But I think that is it, unless either of you guys have anything else.
No, no. Hopefully next week I should have actual stuff to talk about Ender Lilies and not just depression because I couldn't play it. Hopefully.
Until your PS5 controller won't sync to your PC for some reason.
That's the thing. I have to, because I actively use my PS5, I can't use the PS button. I can't use it wireless. I have to use it wired. And so I have to make sure to, like, properly lay the wire on my desktop now so that, like, I can have it comfortably while playing the game.
Yeah, that's... Look, if you ever want to borrow an Xbox controller, I have plenty.
I mean, look, the PlayStation controller is fine. And also, the Stadia controller is fine. It is just this one game that it doesn't work for.
One game and that, like, so far.
Yeah, but like the likelihood of me playing such an indie game in the next year, I might do Titan Souls at some point, but again, like it worked with Death's Door, so it should work for that. Like I have not ran into an issue with this Stadia controller until now, and I doubt I'm going to run into an issue with it in the future.
You'd actually you have a better chance of running into it than you might think, just because Google is not supporting it anymore, so there's not going to be any driver updates or anything.
Yeah.
So, like, that's where you might run into an issue where, like, because there's no updates for it, as Windows gets updated and as games get updated, they just legitimately might not support it anymore because it's out of date.
Yeah, which, it is what it is. It's fine. When that day comes, that day comes. But it's not... I don't need the controller now. Like, it works absolutely fine. It's not the worst controller. It's actually, honestly, it's one of the more comfortable controllers. It's very similar to a PlayStation controller. Very similar to an Xbox controller. Like, it is a very comfortable controller that works well.
It is actually... Heavy. Like, I do agree with you. Like, it is a nice feeling controller. It's just... I don't use a controller on PC enough to warrant doing the stuff to make it recognized as like an Xbox controller. Mm-hmm. And the way that it maps as numbered buttons was, and they're not even like sequential that I could figure, like I couldn't figure out what the actual number ordering was for the buttons. It was more frustration than it was worth trying to like figure that shit out.
Yeah.
So I'm just like, all right, this is just going to sit on a shelf and I'll just use an Xbox controller. But. That'll actually, Rich, are you going to actually start Starfield this week, do you think?
I don't know. I might. It depends on how I'm feeling on Sunday. I initially had planned, I thought I was going to have somebody crash Sunday into Monday, so I was going to have to do some deep cleaning, so I didn't know how much time I was going to be able to stream on Sunday. But if I can put in a decent amount of time, more than like an hour into a stream, or more than like 3 hours into a stream on Sunday, I might do Starfield and then start Ender Lilies on Tuesday. So I don't know. I can't say for sure. I haven't figured it out yet. I might just wait on Starfield until I finish Ender Lilies and just do Ender Lilies. I don't know yet.
Well, because I was going to say, like, I would try and play Starfield this week if you were going to probably have it to talk about next week.
Mm-hmm. I'll let you know. You'll see it on my Discord or something.
Yeah, I'm not going to notice it on there. We all know that.
Well, that's your fault. But, I mean, I won't know until Sunday, so.
That's fair. That's fair.
So, all if right. You're going to play it, just play it.
We'll see. But, yeah, I guess that will do it for this week. Richie's going to go draft some fake football players now.
Yeah.
But if you would like to find more of our content, you can head over to www.one-quest.com. You can also help us out by supporting us at patreon.com/onequest. If you can't support us there with your dollars, though, you can support us... That was wrong. If you can't... I don't know, guys. I don't know. If you can't support us with your dollars, you can go support us by going to your favorite podcast platform like Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify. Rate us, review us, subscribe to us. Those things all help a whole bunch. You can also find us on social media, facebook.com/onequestonline or @one_quest on Twitter and Instagram. Our YouTube channel is youtube.com/onequestvideo, and you can always send us emails to social@one-quest.com. And Rich, what is your streaming?
Checking out twitch.tv/b_walnuts, as well as Kick and YouTube for game streaming Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday. Sunday is either going to be Starfield or Ender Lilies. On Monday is going to be the final of 3 Twitch-only streams where we're playing some Mario Kart, so come hang out and play some Mario Kart with us. And then on Tuesday, since Timmy's not available, we'll probably be Ender Lilies or Starfield, depending on how I'm feeling. And then Thursday's always Sea of Thieves. Come check it out. And Cobb, don't trust me, I get it when it comes to tongue twisters and trying to remember what to say. At the end of every YouTube video, I try to remember to say, make sure to like this video so the algorithm knows that people like you like me too. And I always mess that up.
Yeah, I mean, I will say, I feel like I do a pretty good job, like, 85% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
Every once in a while, either I'll get distracted by something or I'll just be tired and it won't sound right as I'm saying it. Yeah. And I'll start to like overthink what I'm saying. Because a lot of times it's like autopilot. Like I just kind of do it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fine. But if I like stop and think, I'm just like, oh, fuck. Like what words do I use here?
Yeah.
It happens with intros sometimes too. Like I forget how I intro the show sometimes. And I'm just like, oh, what am I supposed to fucking say? Is it high first or is it episode? What? Is it the date? No. But anyway, we will be back next week with something else to talk about.
Episode high, 613. Oh, shit.
Exactly. We'll be back next week with something else to talk about. Thanks for listening. Bye.
See you.
Bye.